instructor of the Undergraduate Research Center in Humanities, Arts, and Social Sciences Division at UCLA. She's also an adjunct assistant professor of the Comparative Literature Department at UCLA. Her presentation is titled Undergraduate Research Opportunities. Let's give her a quick hand of applause.
Thank you, Greg. Okay, so is the mic actually on?
Oh, sorry about that. There's like an on off.
How's that? Okay, if you can't hear me at any point, just raise your hand, okay? And I need to stay behind the podium, so hopefully I will be at the mic so you can hear me. But welcome, everybody. It's great to see you today. So as David said, my name is Whitney Arnold. I'm the director of UCLA's Undergraduate Research Center for the Humanities, Arts, and Social Sciences here. And I'm also an adjunct assistant professor in the Department of Comparative Literature. So my research is on various types of literature. So, but what I want to talk about today is basically research opportunities. So you may have research opportunities at your community college or at your four-year institution. And I want to talk more about what these are, what these might look like. I'll give you some examples from UCLA, but I want this to be a lot broader so you get a broader picture of what this could be. But so my first question is actually, what is research? So I get that a lot from students where I say, you can get involved in research. And people say, well, what is research? So another question for you might be, what does a researcher at a research institution do? Right? Okay, so take a minute. Think about it. What does a researcher at a research institution do? What do you imagine them doing? Okay.
They discover knowledge.
They discover knowledge. They do. Yes. That's good. That's good. Okay. So when you're doing research, you're discovering new knowledge. What else are you doing? I saw a hand. Yeah. Yeah, they pose a question and try to answer that question. So they are posing questions that no one has posed before, right? Kind of exciting. Okay, what else? If you picture a researcher, you picture, you know, a UCLA professor, say, or a professor at any institution doing research, what are they actually doing? Yeah. Okay, reading lots of stuff on archives, perhaps in libraries, at a computer, okay.
So we have our literature review, and would they also be doing like qualitative stuff?
They could be doing qualitative stuff, and I'll give you some examples. Yeah, okay, I saw some hands. Let's go in the back. Yes. Yeah, okay, doing observations, doing surveys, great. Yes, studying people and their interactions, which is what the social sciences is really all about. Okay? Yeah.
They can be like doing experiments in the lab, right? To solve
problems. Yes, do it wearing a white coat perhaps and doing experiments in a lab with pipettes and other things. Go ahead. The white shirt right here.
Oh.
Yeah.
They help the community and in turn they're helped.
Yeah, so you can do community-based research. That's a big one.
Oh, they also present their research, right?
Yes. They present their research. Okay, so that's a good sort of snapshot of what research can look like. And you guys did a lot better than what I normally get, which is either working in a lab with a microscope or reading books in a library. So those are the two answers I normally get. But you guys mentioned archives, and you mentioned, you know, various other things as well. And we're gonna save questions to the end at this point. But please, please, please keep track of your questions, okay? And I'll try to leave plenty of time. And this will be a lot of talking at you, but I hope that it will be interesting. But so yes, research can be working in a lab. If you are in the sciences, for instance, or if you are in psychology, you might be working in a lab, probably not with a microscope in psychology, though you never know if you're in neuroscience, say. Or you could be reading books in the library, but research can look very different in very different fields. So I want to give you some examples of what at least some students at UCLA have been doing. So, analyzing dialogue in TV shows. Going to concerts and examining cultural practices. Who would have thought that going to concerts is research, right? The person I'm thinking of was examining gender in heavy metal music. And so she'd go to shows and interview performers and examine gender. creating a documentary. So we've had lots of students who have created a documentary, one most recently on the LA bus system. Traveling to live and study in other cultures. So we had a student, for instance, studying domestic labor in Ethiopia. We had a student studying tourism in Cambodia and how that was affecting the local economy. You could really go anywhere. We have a student studying religion in Cuba. You could analyze sports practices or statistics. We have a student doing that currently. You could look at an issue pertinent to LA. So I already mentioned the project on the bus system. There's a project currently going on the metro system and ridership and how when people are in a space, they become sort of a community just for that defined period of time. You can find historical materials and archives. So for instance, if your institution has a library that has any sort of special collections, there might be materials in there that no one has ever examined, right? So here at UCLA, a group of students actually found some silent films that had never been seen before. And so they studied them. So that was pretty neat. You could look at pressing international concerns. So we had a student, for instance, who was studying Syrian refugee camps in Jordan and went to Jordan and then ended up with this professor presenting at a UN conference in Jordan on Syrian refugee camps because this issue was so pertinent. You could make a new computer program. One of our students is doing that. He's doing how can a computer, artificial intelligence and machine learning, how can a computer model jazz improvisation? So computer basically composing music. You could create a musical instrument. We had a student doing that. You could study an aspect of pop culture. You could study Twitter. You could study celebrity. We have a student doing a project on Beyonce, right? You could really study anything. And investigating a subject that affects you personally. So we have lots of students studying the education system. I gave two examples, college student stress, which you guys I'm sure don't know about, as well as residence hall life are two topics that are currently being studied. But you could really study anything. So essentially with research is your chance to take whatever interests you and study it really in depth. So that's exciting, right? You could take something that you found in one of your courses and make it into a research project. You can take this question that has just always interested you, that you always think about, and that could be your research. So UCLA is a research institution. A lot of other institutions are research institutions as well. What this means is that our professors are constantly engaging in research, right? So, which also happens at non-research one institutions, but it's really a priority here, right? That the professors here are discovering new knowledge, asking new questions, finding new answers, discovering new knowledge, because it is a research institution. And so why the undergraduate research centers exist here is to involve students in the research mission of this university. So at your institution, your professors are doing research. So the question is, how can you get involved in research, which we'll talk about in a little bit. But research goes on in every discipline, right? So I think a lot of people start out thinking it has to be the sciences, but every single major that there is research going on. And if you want to find out what is going on in your major, you can look at faculty members. They usually have websites, right? So you can go into their websites and say your major is anthropology. Well, go to the anthropology department website at your institution, or if you're planning to transfer at another institution where you want to transfer, and look to see what the faculty members are doing. So maybe they say they're studying this aspect of anthropology that looks fascinating. Well, great. Maybe you want to do research with them. So research goes on in every discipline. It can take two different forms. So research can be faculty initiated or it can be student initiated. So faculty initiated is essentially when the faculty member is working on a research project and you help that faculty member, right? So you can go to the departmental website, you can see this person in anthropology is working on this exciting topic. Maybe they need some help. So maybe you can help them go through literature. Maybe you can help them, if they're in a field where they conduct experiments, maybe you can help with that. Maybe you can help administer surveys. So research can be faculty initiated. You can work on a faculty project. And faculty members all over are looking for undergraduates to help them with their research. On the flip side, it could be a student initiated project. So you might decide, you know, I have really always been interested in the depiction of this in this author's novels, right? You can then find a faculty member to help you with your research. So So two models, work on a faculty member's research or create your own research project and find a faculty mentor to help you with that research project. And just, this is just to give you an example. Other institutions have somewhat similar things. UCLA just launched an undergraduate research portal, which is where undergraduates can go and post research profiles. You can post a profile of yourself, what you're interested in, and faculty members can find you. Or faculty members have posted opportunities. So you can go to this site and you can see which opportunities are posted. And I think at this point there are a couple hundred that have been posted. So if your institution doesn't have something similar to this, which granted I think it is more rare to have an actual sort of automated site, lots of times departments will have research opportunities listings. So say you're a poli sci major. You can, you know, ask in your department, is there a listing of professors who want help with their research? And they can help you with, or they can help you find those. And we'll talk a little bit more about how to find research opportunities. But research can look a few different ways. So you might want to do research for credit, meaning you get course credit for it. So it might be a lower division class. So at UCLA, we have an intro research class, which is just pass, no pass, 1 to 2 units. You can sort of try out research. And then we have upper division classes, where you take research for more credits, you take it for a letter grade, and it's just sort of the upper division version of the lower division class. And it is a contract course, so it is you and the faculty member, and you take this class and you both decide what you're gonna produce at the end of it. So you might sit down with this faculty member and decide, okay, at the end of this quarter or semester, I'm gonna have found, you know, 10 sources and produced an annotated bibliography, or have written a literature review, or I'm gonna produce, you know, a 10-page paper, or I will have collected data from these various forms. So you and the faculty member decide through these research courses what you wanna study, and a lot of schools have versions of these courses. And also, typically, some of them count towards honors. So if you want to write an honors thesis at UCLA or at another institution, you are often engaged in an independent research course with a faculty member as well. Okay? So we talked about research for credit. Sometimes you can find paid research opportunities. So maybe a professor needs help. These tend to be a little bit more often in the sciences or in psychology, but you do see them in the social sciences a fair amount, probably less often in the humanities. But maybe a faculty member needs help with something and they'll pay you to do research as opposed to doing it for academic credit. So that's an option. You could do a research internship. So here at UCLA, we have something called the Center for Community Learning. So you could do research. You could work with a community organization, help them do research, and that becomes your research project. So that's kind of cool to do a sort of a research project in partnership with the community. So that's an option. You could also volunteer. So I would say this is typically more common in the sciences, but some students in the sciences get started with volunteering. So if you talk to a faculty member, you say, I want to help you with your research, and that person says, well, why don't you start by volunteering your time? They're sort of testing you out a little bit, right? They want you to volunteer, maybe work like 5 hours a week in a lab, and then when you show how great you are, then they'll go on to either paying you or taking you on as a student for academic credit, okay? So those are sort of the types of research opportunities that we tend to see. How to get involved. First one is talk to your professors. So think about classes you're taking that really interest you and talk to those professors, because professors are people too, right? So just say, I'm really fascinated in this class. How does it relate to your research? You know, do you need help with your project? But you could also say, I have this project I want to propose. Would you be my mentor? So your current professors, because they know you, are great potential mentors. You could also talk to your undergraduate counselors, so the counselors in your department, in whatever your major is. Those counselors might be able to direct you to some research opportunities. You can also look at faculty websites. So this is probably the most common way that students get involved in research here at UCLA, because they might, you know, not have taken a class with that particular professor whose research interests really dovetail with them, but say, you know, they look at the Department of Sociology website and see that this person is studying this specific thing that interests them above all else. that's a great way to find who's doing what, and we'll talk about then how to contact faculty that you don't know quite as well. But so look at faculty websites to see what people are doing to sort of spark your research interest, as well as see who might dovetail with your research interest. You can start in research programs. So most campuses have some form of research programs, I would say, and we'll talk more about those. And then a lot of campuses have undergraduate research centers. So here at UCLA, we actually have two. So we have one for the humanities, arts, and social sciences, and we have one for the sciences, engineering, and math. And basically, we exist to help undergraduates get involved in research. That is why we are here. So your institution, the UCs, for instance, most of them have undergraduate research centers. And not all of them, though. And at other institutions, it sort of varies. But if you have an undergraduate research center on your campus, do take advantage of it. I would definitely encourage that. Okay, how to contact a potential mentor. So this is the most common question I get. Because students come into the office and say, I'm so excited about research. I want to do this and this and this and this. I'm scared of contacting a faculty member, right? So we get a lot of questions, how do I do this? So if you currently have, if you're taking a class with a professor that you, who you want to do research with, go to their office hours, right? Explain what you want to do, talk to them. But office hours are a great resource, because I can tell you, in my office hours, when somebody shows up, it's like, yay, I don't have to sit here by myself now, right? Because you'd be surprised at how many people don't go to office hours. So first and foremost, go to office hours with faculty that you know whose classes you are taking. So it's probably more common, though, as I mentioned, to not be doing research with a faculty member you currently have a class with. So what do you do if you don't know this person? So say you have looked at the websites for, like here we have the Department of Chicana Studies. So say you've looked at a faculty member's website in that department, and you see what that faculty member is doing, and you really want to study with him or her. So what we advise students to do is start out with an email which asks for a meeting. Because it is unfortunately, so faculty members are busy, right? It is a lot easier for somebody to say no over email than in a meeting. But you still want to sort of introduce yourself. So start out with an email and tell them, you know, my name is so-and-so. I am interested in doing this. And skipping it down a little, what you really want to say is why you want to work with this person. So think about how many, I mean, it is true that faculty members get a lot of emails from potential students who want to work with them. So think about how you're going to distinguish yourself. You want to show that you picked this faculty member for a reason, right? Not just like, oh, you're an anthropologist, I'm an anthropologist, will you mentor me, right? Because why didn't you pick any of the 20 other anthropology faculty? So you really want to show why you're interested in this person's work. So we recommend, you know, a short email, introduce yourself, say what your interests are, say why you think it dovetails with the faculty member's interests, and ask for a meeting. And then in that meeting, you can present your case a little bit more, right, and a little bit more depth about why you want to work with that person. We advise students to bring to send along with that email a CV or a resume. So a CV is basically an academic version of a resume. Who has experienced a CV before, written a CV before? Okay, so resumes are, you know, you submit a resume when you want to apply for a job, right? And so it's your standard sort of work experience and education, things like that. Your CV, your curriculum vitae, details every single academic thing you've done. So, you know, resumes tend to be short, a page or two. A CV can be 50 pages long for a professor. But in a CV, you're really highlighting who you are academically. So on our Undergraduate Research Center websites, we actually have sample CVs. And you can probably go to the career centers at your institutions and find sample CVs as well. But it's basically showing who you are academically. So work experience as it relates to academic stuff. So maybe you were a research assistant. Maybe you worked in a library. Maybe, you know, just something that it shows your sort of research accomplishments to this point. So I would look at sample ones online. But so you can send this email, attach your CV, ask for a meeting. Well, what happens if the professor never writes back? Then you go to office hours, right? Because you know where to find them. So then you can show up at office hours and explain how great you are and why they should take you on as a student. one thing that I would really advise is to read that person's work. So you can say, you know, oh, you study these labor issues and I'm interested in these labor issues and, you know, would you be willing to mentor me? But it's even more compelling if you say, I read your article on X, which made me think of this, and that's why I want to research with you, do research with you, right? So if you can read an article, skim a book, read a book that professor has written, you're really showing that you have done your homework in terms of why you want to work with that person, okay? And you may need to contact more than one mentor. So again, fabs, you're busy. If people don't write you back, don't take it personally. It's just it got there's a whole email pile and it just got lost in there somewhere. Feel free to write back nicely, right? So you can say, oh, I know you're really busy. I just wanted to follow up on my email. You know, would you be willing to meet? And again, you can always track them down in office hours too. But I've actually heard there's a professor here who has told students that unless they email him multiple times, he's not going to respond. Because he wants to work with students who have that persistence that he thinks is entailed in research. I don't think that's the typical case, but I bring that up just to say that often when students say, well, I don't want to email a second time because I don't want to be rude or I don't want them to think that I'm annoying. Well, you have this professor who thinks you should email him multiple times, right? So as long as you do it in a nice way, it is fine. And the reason the undergraduate research centers exist, like I said here at least, is to help students. So we have walk-in consulting with graduate students. So you can say, here's my email, is it okay? Or here's what the professor wrote back, I don't know what to say, is it okay? So if there should be some resource on your campus, even if it's the, say, counselor in your department, who could look over your email if you want that person to. You don't necessarily need anyone to look over it, but who could look over it and tell you, you know, that's, you're highlighting some good things, maybe you want to highlight this, etc. Okay. So, and just to give you sort of a snapshot, so at UCLA, we have, actually, how many undergrads? David, do you know how many undergrads we have on campus right now? It used to be around 25,000, I think it's a little more now. But we have about 4,000 students who participate in individual research with a faculty mentor every year. So that is a very sizable chunk of undergraduates choose to do independent research with a faculty member. And I only bring that up to show you that faculty members are available. So lots and lots and lots of students have found a mentor. And I can't say I've ever found a student who kept trying who did not find a faculty mentor to help with research. So in terms of undergraduate research programs, I mentioned that the campuses have various programs you could get involved in. These look very different in different fields. But so for instance, you could be in a one-quarter program or one-semester program if you're on semesters to a multi-year program. And I'll go over a couple of these. It might be an academic year program, it might be a summer program, it might have a scholarship attached to it, which is always nice. It might have some required coursework attached to it. So one of our programs, for instance, actually a couple of our programs, we require students to take research methods courses as well. It will likely have some aspect of mentoring in it, so you'll get some sort of mentoring with a faculty member or say a grad student if you have grad students on your campus. There's often some graduate school preparation attached to it. So one of our programs, for instance, the students have a GRE preparation course as part of the program. There's often a professional development component, and then there are often presentation and publication opportunities. So research programs can look vastly different, but these are some sort of threads you often see, though not always together, and I would say mostly not together. So like a lot of programs don't have grad school prep, for instance, but these are different components that you might see in an undergraduate research program. So to give you some examples, so every school will have specific research programs. I'm just giving you an example of UCLA because that's what I know, but look for similar programs at your institution. So for instance, we have a program called Spring Into Research, which is just a one-quarter program for students who might want to get involved in research, and they basically just learn what research is. And then by the end of the program, they can construct a research proposal to be part of another program. We have the Undergraduate Research Fellows Program, which is a two-quarter program. We have specific programs that are for various fields. So Educators for Tomorrow, Community Development and Social Justice Scholars are researchers who are interested in specific fields. So these will exist pretty much everywhere. The McNair Research Scholars program exists at a lot of institutions around the country. It is a federally funded program for students students who want to get PhDs. In, oh gosh, I'm saying this, it's social sciences and humanities, right? Yes. So McNair is social sciences and humanities. It is government funded, 2-year undergraduate research program. The Mellon Mays undergraduate undergraduate fellowship program is also a 2-year program. It is also for students who want to get PhDs. Mellon Mays specifically wants to diversify the academy, so you should want to be a professor if you are in Mellon Mays. The Summer Research Opportunities Program and Leadership Alliance, those two are research programs at various institutions that you can apply to. So the SROP schools tend to be more in the Midwest, and Leadership Alliance is more West Coast, East Coast, but you can apply for a summer research program with a professor at another institution. So I can think of two students of ours who recently applied to be in the Summer Research Opportunities Program. One of them went to Michigan, University of Michigan, and one of them went to, I want to say Rutgers, though I could be wrong. It might have been part of Leadership Alliance. And Leadership Alliance, we just had a student study in NYU for the summer, another go to Princeton, and another go to University of Chicago. So these are great programs to apply to if you want to get started in research. And the deadline is usually in February. So be on the lookout for those programs. And then also look for research programs in your field, in your department, and programs that happen to be summer programs. So we've had students, for instance, that I think maybe the one I'm thinking of, Rutgers, actually has a comparative literature specifically for a certain type of philosophy. It had a summer program, right? And we had another student who did a philosophy summer program at Carnegie Mellon, and another one did a philosophy program, it was at actually Case Western. So there are these sort of department-specific or discipline-specific programs that exist everywhere. And a lot of them are in the summer, and you go for a week or two, and you get to learn about your discipline. So be on the lookout for those. In terms of how to prepare a competitive application for a research program, so this is a question that I get a lot. First of all, look at the program requirements. You'd be surprised at how many applications we actually get from students who don't meet the requirements. And as amazing as those applications are, we just can't accept them. So for instance, the Mellon Mays program that I mentioned on the last slide, they support students who want to get PhDs in the humanities and the humanistic social sciences, right? And Mellon Mays is often compared to McNair because they are 2-year research programs. Mellon Mays has a more restricted field focus, though. So if you are studying psychology, you can apply to McNair, but you cannot apply to Mellon. So we get these great applications from students in psychology, and there's just no way we can take them, right? And so really look at the requirements as to, is there a major requirement? Is there a GPA requirement? Which you can always ask, you know, is that a hard cutoff or not? Is there a year requirement? So again, for Mellon Mays and McNair, you need to be able to be on campus for 2 years. If you only have a year left, it's going to be a lot harder to be admitted to that program because it's a 2-year program, right? So look at the requirements first. A lot of these programs you need faculty mentors for when you apply. So look at the requirements for faculty mentors to see whether it's required. Our Spring into Research program that I mentioned, which was just the sort of springboard into research, it's an intro, you don't need a faculty mentor. Most of our other programs, you do need a faculty mentor. So that means that when you are applying to that program, you need to have talked to a faculty member who agrees to be your mentor for this project. So you can say, Professor X is mentoring me on this topic, which is what my research proposal is about, right? So look to see whether a faculty mentor is required. Look to see if they need to be in a specific department. So we did have a summer program, for instance, where the mentors, because of where the funding is coming from, because this is a scholarship program, the mentor had to be in a certain department. So it might be that you have to be in a certain department, but also your mentor might have to be in a certain department. That's more rare, but just check it out, you know, see if it is a requirement. So the word ladder is kind of an interesting word. So have you guys heard the term ladder faculty? Has anybody heard that term? Okay, so faculty members are sort of a system for faculty here, right? Ladder faculty means you are either tenure track or tenured, meaning your title is either assistant professor, associate professor, or professor, or something above that, which is like distinguished professor. So if you are, if you have other titles, if you are a lecturer, if you are an adjunct, if you are, that's probably the main ones, you might not be eligible to be a mentor for that program. So look into this program and see, are there any requirements of what the faculty member needs to have? And if you don't, if the requirements are vague, like if they just say ladder and you're forgetting what ladder is, just ask. So I think that's really helpful in our office. The students come in and say, I want to apply for this program with this mentor, does that work? Right? So you can always just ask, but check to see if there are requirements as to which faculty mentors you can ask to mentor you. And then for some programs, you need to propose a mentor. So I mentioned the two summer programs where you can apply at a bunch of institutions, Summer Research Opportunities Program and Leadership Alliance. And basically, you are applying to those programs and you're saying, okay, I want to do research in linguistics this summer. Then it is up to the faculty mentor, or the program coordinators, to find a mentor for you in linguistics. And that can be hard because people aren't always around during the summer, right? So you sometimes help these programs out if you say, Professor X, you know, that research matches my interests. I'd be interested in working with that person or that person, right? But it varies by program. So I don't want to confuse you further, but I guess the takeaway is that if you're going to be, if you're applying to a program where you're going to be matched with a mentor, I would write the coordinator of that program and ask if you should suggest names or if you should contact that person first. So sometimes the program coordinator might be just swamped, you know, can't find anybody in linguistics, but if you've already said, oh, so-and-so agreed to mentor me, then they're like, great, done, right? Whereas they might not have taken the effort otherwise. But it could be that they have a defined system in place, and if you go ahead and contact a mentor, you're sort of circumventing the system and they don't like that. So if you think you need to find a mentor, I would just write the program coordinators and ask if you should be contacting mentors yourself or if they will match you up with a mentor. And then finally, check out the selection process. So for some of our programs, we have interviews, and students just haven't been available. Well, that's a problem. So you need to be available. Just check out what the selection process is and make sure you can meet all of those stages of the selection process. Okay, research proposal. So when you're applying to undergraduate research programs, the components of the application can vary greatly. But I want to talk about just two components that you tend to see a lot in various shapes and forms in undergraduate research programs applications. So the first that you will see is a research proposal in some way, shape, or form. So this is some sort of statement saying why you are applying to this research program and what you want to study, okay? So what you propose to research and accomplish. And these are, I'm just gonna go through some parts that we suggest including, but again, whatever you are applying to, read the instructions carefully because they might give you totally different things to focus on, okay? But what we tend to ask for, first and foremost, is what is your research question? So what do you want to study? And what is the significance? So you might want to study, you know, X, Y thing, but you need to argue why somebody should care. So that's what the significance is. And you might know that you think Beyonce is so great and deserves a research project, but the people reading your application might not agree with that, right? So then you have to argue about her cultural impact and this and why this question that you want to study is so important. So when you articulate your research question, what you want to study, be sure to include its significance. Why you want to study this? Why is it important? Why should people read it? Why should people care? This often, but not always, involves a literature review of sorts. So a literature review, if we sum it up, is just basically showing that you have read some other research on the topic. An analogy I like to give for the literature review is, think about if you are going to a dinner party, right? Because we all go to so many dinner parties. If you're going to a dinner party, and you don't just walk in, people are in the midst of conversation, right? You don't just walk in and start talking. No, you walk in, you see what everybody else is talking about, and then you talk about something that somehow fits into that conversation. So that is what a literature review is doing. In a literature review, you're showing that you have read work on that research question roughly, and then you're showing how your project relates. So for instance, though those so-and-so, so-and-so, and so-and-so have written about the LA Metro system in these ways. My project examines this, right? Or though these five people have studied my research question in this way, I want to go further. I want to add on to this research by doing this. So the literature review basically just shows that you are not just blindly plunging into your research question, but you have some sort of basis for what has been done before and what you want to do to add to it. And then we usually ask for a section on project design. So it will include your methodology. How are you going to study this research question? So are you going to do surveys? Are you going to do interviews? How many people? Are you going to read two texts and analyze them? Are you going to go to archives? Anything about your methodology is really helpful, as well as the timeline. So, you know, if it's a two-year research program, find out, for instance, what typical students do in each quarter and construct a timeline that matches it. So you might, if your timeline is, okay, in winter I'm gonna do this, and in spring I'm gonna do this, and then I'll be done, and the research program is 2 years long, people are gonna be like, well, what are you gonna do the rest of the time, right? So try to construct a timeline that is feasible and that matches the program. So that shows you're really thinking about what you can accomplish in this program, because one of the things that people are evaluating you for is this feasible, right? And so that's the feasibility part. So if you say, I'm gonna do this amazing project where I'm going to get 10,000 people to respond to a survey in the next 2 weeks, and your project depends on that, well, you know, that's a tough sell. So people might not think that that's possible. So you wanna make sure that whatever you're proposing is possible for you to do. So look at the feasibility of it. And then in a lot of research proposals, you'll include anticipated results. So it's basically, you've had your hypothesis, what do you think is gonna happen? I would say this is probably less common in the humanities, more common in the social sciences and the sciences to include your anticipated results, but you can still include it in the humanities. You could still say, you know, I think by analyzing these three novels or these two pieces of artwork, I will encounter this and this and this. So that's sort of a snapshot of what a research proposal looks like. If it's applicable, you could propose a mentor. So if you are applying to those summer research programs I mentioned where you have to be matched with a mentor, and if you're told you should propose someone, then you might talk about why this person's a good fit for your research. This actually can be, in a way, a lot of these elements would go into a statement of purpose for graduate school, if you guys are applying to graduate school, because in graduate school, they want to know what you want to study and why and who you want to work with, right? And so, you, in those statements, you would want to say, I want to work with Professor so-and-so and because you really want to illustrate the purpose of that. So if the program is preparing you with the mentor, or if actually, even if you've already found your own mentor, it could be useful to say, you know, I want to work with Professor so-and-so on this because, and show how they're useful to your research project. So you're really showing that you've done your homework in terms of finding a mentor. And then your personal statement. So this is the other component that a lot of research programs include or ask you to do. So your personal statement is basically you, right? It's a statement about you, but as it relates to your research. So it's great that when you were seven, you did this and this and this and this, but how does that relate to your research? So if when you were seven, you went to this one place that then is the basis for now your current research proposal, great. Talk about that, but make sure it's relevant to the research proposal. So you might talk about your interests. Lots of times this is where students address any obstacles that they've had to overcome, just to give the committee sort of a bigger picture of themselves. Any relevant experiences you've had that might be relevant to you doing research or to your research project. Basically, this is just your time to give the committee who's evaluating your application a larger picture of you as a person and why you would be a good fit in this program, okay? Often students address their short and long-term their goals. So it might be career goals, it might be graduate school goals, and then how this program will help them to accomplish this. So you're applying to this program for a reason, why? Hopefully it's not just for, I have had a student say, oh, I just want the money, I don't care about the research, about a scholarship program, and I have to say that's not a very compelling argument. So, you know, why is being in this program useful, and how will it help you accomplish your short-term goals maybe in terms of your research project, maybe in terms of your undergraduate experience, but also your longer term goals. And then any special circumstances that you don't think are reflected in the application, you can include it in your personal statement as well. Okay? And we're doing well in time, I think. Okay. So the final thing I wanted to mention is that when you do undergraduate research, you'll often have presentation opportunities and maybe even publication opportunities. And these are great because one of the biggest fears that people have is public speaking, right? I mean, who here loves public speaking more than anything else? Okay, all right, so we have some good, we have some enthusiastic public speakers. I would say that the more of the students I talk to are terrified to public speak, right? And that's why research opportunities are great, because they can really, they can give you these presentation opportunities. So this is actually a photo from Pauley Pavilion, where a basketball team plays, where we have part of Undergraduate Research Week here on campus. So that's actually the Jumbotron. So it's huge, up in the middle of Pauley Pavilion. It says Undergraduate Research Week. And under this, we had 800 students giving research posters and presenting their research to attendees who are community members, faculty, other students, so you really got to see what students are doing. So it is a wonderful chance to present your research, or it's wonderful to present your research when you are doing it, because it's one thing to do it, it's another to have to articulate it, right? I mean, if you think about that, that's kind of true in life. It's easier to do something than to sort of explain it and articulate your goals and why you did it and present it in this nice, neat package. So a lot of these programs do have presentation opportunities that go along with them. There are also two big conferences that students from anywhere can submit to. So the Southern California Conferences for Undergraduate Research are happening soon. I want to say the deadline is around November 1st to submit. You usually submit an abstract of your project, so that could be, say, you know, 5 to 8 sentences on what your research is that you want to present. And then it usually happens sometime in December or so, and it's in Southern California, so it's easier to get to than some of these other conferences. And then the other big undergraduate research conference is called the National Conference on Undergraduate Research. That varies between different places around the country. But that's sponsored by the Council for Undergraduate Research. And then there are probably tons and tons and tons of conferences in your field. So be on the lookout for conferences as well. So just to sum up in terms of resources, if you want to get involved in research, if you want to be in a research program, talk to your professors, talk to advisors in your department, talk to your other folks in your departmental offices, and if there is an undergraduate research center, you can always go and ask them questions. Or even if there's not a center, there might be somebody whose responsibility is focused on undergraduate research. Okay, questions now that I've talked to Addie. First question is, when is the Southern California Conference for Undergraduate Research? I should know this. It happens every around winter,
okay.
But I think the deadline is around November 1st, and it'll usually happen in December.
Okay.
So it's soon. It happens soon.
So if I were to submit my work, is it possible to do it, to present it, even though I've already graduated?
Oh yeah.
Okay.
You can present your research in any stage of the process. So look at the conference and see if the conference has any requirements, like you must be a current student. But if this is your last quarter year, you would be a current student by the time you present. Yeah, so conferences do vary in terms of their requirements, but you can present a project that's completed, you can present a project you haven't worked on in the last year, you can present a project that you just started. So often I have students say, well, how can you present a project that has just started? Because they think they'd be just finished with research, even though you're never really finished, right? There's always more questions you can ask. But maybe you just started, but you still have accomplished this one tiny part, right? You can still present that at a conference. Other questions? Yes? Transferring to an institution, and so basically if you want to apply to a research program at an institution that you're just transferring to. So yes, you might be asking a stranger to be your mentor. So to give you an example, in our Mellon Mays program, so students, transfer students come into UCLA in late September or early October. The deadline for our Mellon Maze program is November 15th. So it doesn't give you much time. 2 years ago, every single one of the students was a transfer student who was admitted to the program. This year, everyone except for one is a transfer student. So it is very possible. And basically what these students have done is just come in and started asking questions, started looking around for resources, approached faculty members who maybe they had a class with right then, or maybe they didn't know, and they set up meetings through departmental websites, but basically just got started pretty quickly, right? But if you're worried about doing that, I think it's actually a good thing to do, because if you're transferring, you don't have that much time at that institution, right? So why not just get started right away? But a lot of other people are in the same boat too. So if you're feeling a little awkward about it, tons of other people are feeling awkward too, and they're in the same situation. They're also trying to find mentors.
If someone gives you a research grant, does that cover traveling to conferences?
Good question. So the question is the research grant. So if you are in a research program that has a scholarship portion attached to it, it could vary on what that scholarship does cover. So with our scholarships, we actually just put it into students' financial aid accounts. So it could go to offset loans, it could go towards housing, you can basically spend it as you want. Some other scholarship programs, it might be that you need to spend this on the project you proposed. So maybe you've proposed a budget, and you say, this summer for my research, I want to accomplish this and this and this, here's what it will cost to do it, and then you get funded for that. So it really varies per program as to what the money would cover if it does come with the scholarship. Right, okay, so if you want to do research abroad, it could look different, just depending on which programs you want to do. Some students just do research abroad, right? So, for instance, we have a faculty member in art history, and the students that she works with, they're sort of digitally reconstructing 13th century Parisian buildings that are lost, so people can see what these buildings used to look like, and so she takes them to France, and they go to Paris, and they study in Paris for a while, and that's just part of working with that faculty member, is they do go abroad. Some of our other students who've gotten research scholarships say, here's the thing I want to accomplish for my scholarship. As part of, say, fall quarter, I need to go to this location to work. And so that's part of the program. But it could be, definitely look at requirements of anything you're applying for, because it could be that whatever you're applying for needs you to be on campus, if they need you to take certain courses. So it really just varies per program. Yeah. And there are some field-specific programs abroad. So when you're researching research programs in your field, you might find some stuff abroad. So we had an art history student, for instance, and the program that she did was an archaeological dig in Greece, and that was her research. So she needed to go to Greece, obviously, which is a good problem to have.
What happens if you're at a community college that isn't necessarily privileged when it comes to research, and you're sort of stuck on the wasteland, you still want to be a part of it?
Right, right. So what you could still, so the question is, what if you're in a community college that might have sort of the research infrastructure? There are probably still a lot of faculty members who are doing research in some way, shape, or form. So if there's still departmental websites where you can look to see if the person has published any articles or is teaching, even if you haven't seen if they've published any articles, but they're teaching in a certain area, they could still advise you as to that project, right? Because in order to teach at a community college, they have achieved a basic level of research knowledge and skills so that they could advise you. But then there are always programs, so there are a lot of research programs with four-year institutions. The ones at UCLA tend to be more in the sciences, but there are programs specifically for community colleges, for students who are at community colleges to come do research at UCLA. So look for those too. So I know there's specifically one in the sciences for students at Santa Monica College, which is really nearby, to come do research at UCLA. But as part of, if you're in a field that the National Science Foundation applies to, so like sociology or some areas of the social sciences, the NSF has specific research experiences for undergraduates grants, where a component of the grant is that the institution that gets it has to involve community college students. So if you see these, they're called NSF-REUs, Research Experiences for Undergraduates, and the institutions that have those will typically involve community college students as well as their own students in those programs. Other questions?
Yeah. It's not quite a question, it's kind of a comment on that. When I was in community college, there's the National Transfer
few more minutes. Any final questions? Go ahead. Yeah. Right. Okay. So yeah, we didn't talk about publication opportunities. So I should just mention as well, since I think a lot of you here are interested in going to graduate school and PhD programs, you should do undergraduate research if at all possible, right? Because you are going to graduate school to do research. So having done it as an undergraduate shows that you can already. You're basically saying, I want to do this, and here's what I've already done. And so you will have a leg up on anyone who hasn't had those sort of those bigger research experiences, right? And so if you've presented at a conference, even better. Take advantage of all those opportunities because it shows that you have, now you know how to present your work and you know how to be part of this research community, which is the type of community you'd be joining in grad school. And then publications, I would say, are more rare, but they're even more impressive to graduate schools, right? Because publications still are sort of the be-all, end-all in terms of what you need for graduate school and to become a faculty member. You are sort of evaluated on your publications. So as undergraduates, it's a lot more rare to be published, but if you are working with a faculty member on a faculty member's research project, often they might involve you as an author on the project, so you could get a publication out of that if you're working with a faculty mentor, and you would want to talk to them about, what kind of work would you want me to do in order to get a publication out of it. So it would be a list of names, and you would be one of them, right? You probably wouldn't be first author, but you would be one of many authors. But you can always submit your work to journals. So I would say it's probably, you have a better chance of being published in an undergraduate research journal. So here at UCLA, we have a publication called Aleph, which is an undergraduate research journal for the humanities and social sciences. There's also a publication called the Undergraduate Science Journal here at UCLA. And those journals publish UCLA students' work. The first one, it's called Aleph, so it's, this isn't yours, is it?
No.
Okay. So the one at UCLA, for humanities and social sciences, it's called Aleph. And, can you not see
it? Is it an A?
A-L-E-P-H. I also have bad handwriting. So it's called Aleph. It publishes work by current UCLA graduates or students who have graduated within the past year. So there's also the Undergraduate Science Journal, but other campuses have undergraduate journals as well. And they might only publish work for their own students, but a lot of them publish work for a bunch of different students. So we always get a copy of Case Western's Discussions Journal, which is an undergraduate research journal, and I want to say that's open to everybody. So look around, research some undergraduate journals. On our current website, actually, the Undergraduate Research Center Humanities, Arts, and Social Sciences website, we have a section for publication opportunities, and it takes you to a listserv of what some undergraduate publications are. So you can look at that. I would say look at it soon because our website's going to change within the next month or so, and it might not be up anymore. But you can Google and find undergraduate research publications. Probably have time for about one final question.
So I know, I know that for a lot of community college transfer students, they're kind of intimidated to apply for very selective undergraduate research programs like McNair and Mellon Mays. And I know that UCLA is a little bit different, but should transfer students be intimidated to apply?
Oh my gosh, no. No, I mean, I think the statistics I gave on Mellon Mays, how the vast majority have been transfer students in recent years, just should show you that as a transfer student, if you look at Mellon Mays, it would seem you have an advantage. Do not be intimidated in any way, shape, or form. I think that most people, whether you enter, say, UCLA, if I'm looking at UCLA application, whether the person came in as a freshman or came in from a community college, no difference, right? And you guys have gotten some pretty stellar preparation at a lot of your community colleges. I'd say the vast majority of your community colleges. So you should be proud of that and really apply to everything you can, and even if you are at an institution that you feel like is a little bit under-resourced, well, when you go to that four-year institution, you were admitted there for a reason, right? And you are just like, you are on the same plane with everybody else else who's also applying for research scholarships, so in no way, shape, or form should you be intimidated. Yeah. Although, I mean, everybody's intimidated when they're applying, because that's the name of the game, right? But everybody is. So it doesn't matter who exactly you are, that what they're looking at is your research. You know, what do you want to accomplish, and how are you going to accomplish this? So yeah, you guys should have confidence as you apply for these things, and apply. Because if you never apply, you're never going to get it, right? So I've had students who say, oh, I don't know if it's good enough, I don't know. You'd be surprised, just apply. You're your own harshest critic, right? So just apply. And if everybody felt the same way, which most people do, then nobody would apply and we'd have no one in our program. So those spots are there for a reason. So you guys are great. That's the takeaway. All right, well, it's nice to talk to you all. Have a good rest of your day.
Okay, so right now we're going to take a 15-minute break, and then we'll get started with our next presentation straight at 2:45. If you guys have questions for Dr. Whitney Arnold,